So Dr. Sheetal Mauvekar is our next speaker. She is the senior consultant of cataract, cornea and refractive services at the Retina Foundation in Ahmedabad. Can you please share your screen?
Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Yeah.
I am not able. Huh, okay, yes. So thank you so much, Chitra ma'am. So my case is very similar to what Dr. Amit has shown. Basically, it's a PPC case. So recently, what I've started doing is, after ruling out the retinal and glaucoma pathology, I started giving them the IOL options of monofocal as well as multifocal. Along with that, every PPC case, we do tell them about maybe the need of anterior vitrectomy, maybe the need of retinal surgery, or the retina surgeon getting involved. So after explaining everything and telling them that the change of the IOL, the plan of the IOL can change on table. So I started my surgery pretty well doing the Rexis and I generally plan hydrodelineation in the PPC case. So when I did this hydrodelineation, I thought that delineation did not happen. I wasn't very sure whether that was a hydrodissection or delineation, but as you can see, the iris started coming out through the main wound. Now, the mistake I made out here is started going through my main wound again, and I repeated delineation because I thought it was an incomplete delineation. What I noticed, and which is not very well visible in this video, is the AC started getting very, very shallow, and there was an upthrust of the nucleus. Iris started coming out from the main wound. I tried putting the iris initially through the main wound, which you should not do it, as Dr. Tamil, I think, has very nicely said that one should not go through the main wound because it keeps coming out, and sometimes you can cause holes if you start going through the same wound. So eventually I realized that okay, that's not which is working, and I went through the side port and kind of reposited my iris back. Now there was hardly any space for me to go and do anything in this particular case because AC was extremely shallow. As it was a plain case of PPC, there was no nucleus sclerosis part. What I decided in this particular case is, let's just reposit the iris properly and go ahead with the irrigation aspiration instead of putting the thick probe inside the AC where there's hardly any space for me to work on it. So I continued with irrigation aspiration, and this, I'm just showing it in a fast forward. As you can see it, when I was doing the irrigation aspiration, I saw this particular rent which was there, a nice posterior capsular dehiscence was there. Now at this point in time, I'm not very sure whether it caused because of my either hydrodelineation, which got converted into dissection, or it was like pre-existing dehiscence. So before taking out the cortex, what I generally prefer, it was a big rent, I decided to go ahead with the pars plana approach of anterior vitrectomy, which is my general approach now, where go only by one port and this irrigation is through the side port. This is a video, thanks to Dr. Sambhesh and Shail, I've taken it just to show what happens when you do the anterior vitrectomy through the limbal approach and what happens through the pars plana approach. Anterior vitrectomy through the limbal approach, basically the vitreous is just coming out, so it can increase your rent, whatever is there. But if you do it through the pars plana, the rent remains almost the same size and you cause less damage, I think, to the capsule in general. So after doing the anterior vitrectomy, I decided to go ahead with my irrigation aspiration. At some point in time, I thought there was one strand. The ideal thing to do out here is putting tricot and do your anterior vitrectomy. Somehow, I did not do it in this particular case, and I do not, to be very frank, every time put the tricot because sometimes I don't like that view which disturbs, and a lot of tricot goes into the vitreous and sometimes can cause glaucoma later on. So, but looking at this particular rent, I decided that, okay, we had spoken about and we had discussed about the multifocal IOL, and because that rent was central, I decided to put in the multifocal lens and go ahead with my plan. As Dr. Ramamurthy had said that after every case where there is a kind of iris prolapse or where iris is like little floppy, I like to put the air at the end of the surgery so the iris actually nicely sits back. So this is a picture which is 7 day post-op, and I hope that it remains like this. Although this is the first time I have done something like this where there's a rent in the PPC and I went ahead and did my multifocal IOL. Generally what I do is I will go ahead with my multi-piece IOL. So at this point in time, I would like to ask the panelists, A, should we go ahead with multifocal? B, because this rent was slightly bigger, I decided not to convert it into the posterior capsulotomy, because at that point in time, I thought that if I convert it, it will become too big an opening and I may not be able to put my multifocal lens. So I would like to have some comments on this. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Sheetal, for your video. I just felt that I should more for the attendees' sake that we need not be so gaga about doing a pars plana vitrectomy in all cases, because these are hypertonous eyes and placing a trocar might be a challenge for an anterior segment surgeon. I believe that if you have two snug fit side ports and if you are able to go and do vitrectomy behind the posterior capsule deep down, and one, your infusion, which is directed away from the vitreous cavity, why should you have a lot of vitreous loss and vitreous getting overhydrated? I think it could be just the limited vitrectomy which is needed. I wanted the thoughts of expert panel on this.
Want me to answer?
Yes.
Yeah. I think she did a wonderful job putting a trocar and cannula into the vitreous cavity and doing a pars plana anterior vitrectomy with an anterior chamber maintainer. That is the way to go. But only thing is, I would have used a diluted tricot. 1:4 diluted or 1:3 dilution that takes care of the, because unless you use tricot, you will not know whether your vitreous is completely removed or not. Vitreous is a colorless substance. And unless you have a very high end microscope, it's very difficult to see the vitreous. So another thing is, I wouldn't have put a multifocal lens in this case. I would have put basically a multi-piece lens and in the sulcus and put it in the captured the lens in the back, because this lens, the tear is a little large, and during the implantation, fortunately you were lucky during the implantation, it didn't extend, but it could have done, and you could have seen next day sometimes the lens is on the retina. So that is what I would have done in this case. But what was the reason for the posterior capsule? Was it hydro rupture?
I really don't know. So that's what I said, that because my hydro delineation was really not good in this case. Although I thought that I went into the substance of the lens and did it. But if you remember, when I did the hydro delineation, I did not see a ring and I really did not see a good hydro delineation. So I think instead of hydro delineation, what happened, there was a hydro dissection. And that could be the cause instead of
it is probably mutation. An accidental hydro dissection,
yes,
which has occurred, and probably that has caused the PC rent.
I think it was a hydro dissection, and that's why you get such a this thing. The only thing I'll agree with Mohan is that I wouldn't go in for a single piece lens, and I wouldn't definitely not go in for a presbyopia correcting lens, because any amount of decentration which could be there could have a problem. And one more practical tip is that at least since the chances of of having a pre-existing rent, etc., are much higher, all our patients are counseled with a posterior polar cataract. Whether it's a TPA case, we ask for an approval for cataract plus anterior vitrectomy.
Yes, so that we do, sir.
We always write plus minus anterior vitrectomy, because it becomes very difficult for a patient to pay later. Because the point is that that's a different package which we have. So, and also we have all the lenses that are available, a three-piece, even if you have to go in for a glued IOL. So the preferred lens, which a lot of surgeons have, is MA60. Otherwise, we go in for a Technis three-piece, and we have the single piece, and you can have. So the patient is counseled and a special consent is taken, because quite often this is the problem that can happen. And never ever believe just what the patient has given you or not given you a history. Always look at the other eye. at times when you have a hard cataract or something like that with a posterior polar, I still remember there was a patient who came and I started doing my phaco without realizing. This was I think before 2004, because I remember it was in my Green Park Center. And within seconds, we did a hydro and the whole thing went down and I didn't know what to do. And at that time, I didn't have a retina support. So I sent it to Cyrus to take it out. And then on careful examination, he had a Kelman multiplex in the other eye, which we had missed. And the patient said exactly the similar thing had happened, that we had to, the nucleus had fallen down, but that history was never given to you. So looking at the other eye, specifically in patients in which you can't see the posterior aspect, is something very, very important if you are operating on the second eye, because often patients don't divulge this particular fact. And taking a preoperative consent and a preoperative, if you have different charges, if you have to do an anterior operation, and having all the lenses standby is, and a retina guy possibly around to have that if there is a nuclear ball behind.
Just a comment.
That if this case PCR could be converted to a PCC, then you're more confident about placing a single piece in the bag. But if the patient has had a multifocal in the other eye and you're compelled to do it in this eye, you could do place a three-piece multifocal with a good optic capture, and these patients do well.
So just now, Dr. Chitra, a three-piece multifocal is, I ended up in a situation like this and I had to actually search for a three-piece multifocal. It's only the Technis platform that was available, and it had to be got from the distributor in Ambala. So I had to wait for...
also my part. I mean, in the sense that we keep a library of three-piece multifocals. They're really available in these situations. And
what all powers is it?
Huh?
All powers we have?
Yeah. We have a library of three-piece multifocals.
We have a PPC. I think I should call you. Probably call you. Send the lenses to me also.
Seriously, Sheetal, I mean, I think it was hydro dissection, as others pointed out, and it was not hydro delineation. Maybe that's not the only factor. So much discussion happens about classification of posterior polar cataract, etc. But I think any PPC, the approach should be the same, whether you suspect that it's an open PPC, I mean, anywhere you could land up with a problem. In your particular case, because obviously a posterior capsular excess was not possible because it was too large a tear. Yeah. But now having placed the lens there and the final picture that you showed with a good rexis overlap, I don't think this patient is going to suffer in any way. I mean, you have done adequate anterior vitrectomy.
I recently saw, sir, the 3 weeks post-op of this patient. So he's doing pretty well. The lens is exactly the same, but still I think it's a bit of a risk which I took it over there. And as I said, it was the first time I did decide to put MFIOL. I generally put the multi-piece in such cases. But as ma'am said, that the other eye had the multifocal. So I think I was that time in the double mind what to do with it.
No, as I said, you know, in these situations, I would have definitely gone ahead with a three-piece multifocal in the bag with an optic capture. But having landed in this situation, having put a lens inside, since there's a lens seems to be well-centered and you have a central opening, there's a good rexis overlap, I think this patient will continue to do well. There's no vitreous strands in the anterior chamber, but obviously this is not something you would play with and hope that it comes out well. I think with such a large rent, it's always a good idea to go with a three-piece lens.
Absolutely.
I think the take-home message should be that we should not put the lens in the bag if we don't have the rounding of the PCCD, because if it is not rounding, so if it is rounded, then even a larger one you can risk going into the and putting it in the bag. But if it is not rounded, the take-home message should not be implanted whatsoever in the bag.
And as Dr. Mahipal sir said, we actually do counsel plus minus anterior vitrectomy and even tell the patient everything and even keep all the lenses ready. But I did not know about this three-piece multifocal lens. So I think that's again a good idea. For such cases where one eye has multifocal and you are always in a doubt what to do if such a thing arises.
Multifocal is a good choice. And I will fully endorse Mahipal. Look at the fellow eye, especially when you have a brown cataract, you do not know whether it's a positive or a white cataract. Look at the fellow eye and ask, also ask the patient how much time it took for the surgery. Whether it took 10 minutes or 1.5 hours, he will tell you invariably, he says, it took a long time, sir. Yeah, 1 to 1.5 hours. It means that there is a nucleus drop in that patient and PC tear was there and the lens was in the sulcus or a iris claw lens or an AC IOL, whatever it is. Look at the fellow eye, very, very important.
Thank you, Dr. Sheetal. That was a wonderful video.